Three stars! We got swag back.
Yo,
raise your hand if you like the soundtrack.
I'm really sorry about him. I stole his line. That's his line all the time to me. I'm really sorry about my friend.
Sorry about my friend Chris Pine over here. You're not Chris Pine?
No,
my
Chase
is a bad real.
I'm kidding. I know you're Chase Crawford. I watched this. Okay, how did everybody like the movie?
I feel good. I'm glad we're here. How's that no comment sweater working out for you?
I'm getting so much attention, mostly from men wearing this in the city. Men and birds. I just had birds land on me, like LaVonna Hardy. First off, we're not just like saying it to say it. Thank you so much for coming through the snow. Could have done anything with your Saturday night, and you came here. Thank you so much. Give yourselves a round of applause for being here. Thank you. I'm going to start out with a question for Sebastian. We'll ping pong this for a second. How do you get your bedhead to look so beautiful?
It's all coconut oil.
Is it really?
That's all I get. Yeah, from Whole Foods. What can I say?
Whole Foods.
How do you get that illustrious beard to shine so bright?
I wake up every morning, I look in the mirror, And I tell the mirror, I'm asking him to change his ways. No message gonna get any clearer. Let me ask you a real question. What was it like working with Margot Robbie, who you had seen in movies before, and you knew a little bit about her, but you're kind of going in with like a heavy hitter. She's like Hollywood's it girl.
You're so good at this.
I
don't know. I was very nervous, I guess, because I had to screen test with her, and then that was terrifying, I suppose, for the most part.
What was that screen test like?
The screen test was a little weird for me because I'd gotten there and I guess I had the wrong time, and then I ended up waiting for about an hour before I went in, and I got really nervous and I thought I like lost the character or whatever, and I didn't really think it went very well, and then I guess it had, but it was good because we kind of established a sense of trust from the get-go, and she's obviously an incredibly generous actress, but she's got this charisma, and she was really, really obsessed with this material, and it was good because obviously we have some really difficult scenes in the movie, and I think you want to be able to work with somebody who you can trust and who also can laugh with you about some of the things you're wearing in the film. I also felt bad if she ate about 15 of those mustaches throughout the film as we were making out, but...
Let me ask you this. You've done the sort of sword and sandal cape superhero thing, which is like, I don't say that
that's
like literally.
That's my turn next to this.
I would love a Marvel film right now. My bank account needs a Marvel film right now. I'm curious though, because you've
he
done...
He just went out for Gambit, by the way. I'm just...
Hey,
I don't know. I'm just putting it out there for you.
No, you didn't hear that.
We're really gonna try to remake Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
Can you see that John Candy and Steve Martin? We can do it. I'm curious because you've done some of the bigger, crazy stuff, and this is a smaller film with like intimate, dark material. Is this something you're going to keep trying to look for to differentiate? Because you have a lot of range, obviously.
Yes, these kinds of characters. Like everything I ever always looked
for. You playing sickos? Rail thin sickos?
Yeah.
No, what? No, you man, met Jeff. You met Jeff.
You're always trying to do something different, I guess. And then, you know, in this case, it was kind of weird and terrifying because, you know, it was a person that existed, and so there was a pressure to that, to having to like mold to something, and especially a character like this, like on the page, was essentially very funny to me because all the things that the two of them really like went on, you know, like they actually did drive 8 hours just so he could scream at her across, like, you know, a whole figure skating sort of warehouse, whatever alley, and they really, you know, Sean really did follow him around like that at one point. I asked him about Sean, and I guess he said that Sean was always the kid in a mesh shirt never went away.
He was Galooly's Kimmy Gibbler.
But he's being very humble because the truth is I actually got to see his audition tape. You know, we were in rehearsal with Craig and Margo, and then they were like, you got to see this guy, you know. It's not James Corden, but it's way, way, way better. And it's true, and because, you know, how was your audition process when you went in?
Well, I mean, that was the thing, is I went in knowing that I was some sort of a backup plan for if they couldn't get a name, which, by the way, they should. You got to push the movie, you got to get somebody who's brilliant, somebody who has a fan base. Like, that's part of the job, but... when I was in the room, I could tell at Mary Verneau's office in Los Angeles, I was in the room with Craig for a director's session, and I could already tell we were just kind of vibing, like any good job interview or audition, if there are any actors in the room, like, you kind of know midway through if you might have the job or not, and I at least knew that Craig and I were getting along, and that I could stay malleable and be teachable with him on set if we got to do it, so that was good.
And you, I believe you spoke to, obviously, you couldn't find Sean for... You know,
Sean passed away 10 years ago.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But you did talk to someone who knew Sean, right?
Right. I tracked down the guy who turned him into the FBI because his name had been name dropped throughout local news affiliates during all the... Because you go on YouTube, you look up the footage of like all the news reports and stuff, and this guy, Eugene Saunders, kept getting brought up. So I looked him up and called him, and he called me back from his Bible college. He's like a theology professor. Apparently, he had a knack for... calling out injustices even back then. He was a very old man. He was really cool, and he just told me, like, listen, Sean told everybody on our college campus that he was involved in that. And within days, everybody knew, and we all felt like accessories for knowing those that did know. So he was the one who turned him in, but I got some good intel there. Yeah.
Well, anyway, so that's some of that.
Craig Cacray. We probably got a bunch of questions.
Anybody want to talk about anything?
They're like, yes, we have to
go for it. Sir, over there.
Was that? Me? Oh, okay.
Oh, well, yeah, you're next, but oh, I think that. The gentleman behind you.
Cheers, guys. My name is Francis Duncan, and in fact, I'm from Constanza, Romania. I'm calling Constanza.
Aww. Oh, hello.
Sebastian.
Yes.
And I want to say you did a fantastic job, both of you. And I saw that the ice cream is actually familiar. It was from Atlanta, right?
Yeah, everything was in Atlanta, yeah.
Atlanta. I actually filmed a movie there, and I was able to ice skate a few years when I was living in Atlanta before moving to New York last year. And I want to say, I noticed your I've noticed other projects you have, and I have to say that this one is very intriguing because you took a depth into the character, and I'm curious to know, what was the distinctive element that you took to portray this character?
You could say about Sean too, but a distinctive element that I took to portray this character?
As in, how did you prepare for it? And
well, like I said, I mean, for both of us, I mean, but there was footage there to some extent. The only thing about the Jeff, if you go and look, there's like an inside edition thing. That was years after everything happened. He talks a little bit then, and then I just listened to that, and I had the interview on audio that Stephen Rogers, the screenwriter, did with him, and that was very helpful to kind of start to get an idea of how he sounded and stuff. But I had to go and meet with him, which was weird and kind of scary because, you know, I walked in with all these preconceived ideas about who, you know, you heard he was, and Tonya says all these things about him, and you know, he... was just like a very simple, regular guy, seemingly, you know. But that was helpful to kind of piece together who he was. And so that's what I'm saying, like, as opposed to a script where you're using your, you know, you have to build everything up from the ground up, that this was more like a detective story in a way, because we both had to go in and...
And YouTube was crazy helpful for, like, all of us, I think.
Yeah, I mean, you had that... There's...
The whole Diane Sawyer interview that Sean does where he's like, I work for counterterrorism. Like, that's like verbatim, like 95% what he really truly said in the Diane Sawyer interview. So for the audition, I memorized the hell out of that, and also like the body language. And I'm trying to find like I'm a big fan of Peter Sarsgaard, who I love. He's like my Brando or whatever. And like Sarsgaard, when he plays real people, he said he doesn't want to mimic them. It's not about mimicry, or else you're just robotically going through motions to look or sound like someone. So even though I was trying to get into like the body and the body language and the look and his kind of like squinty, doughy face, I was also trying to figure out what's behind that. And most of what was behind it was a lot of pain, I think. And you're masking pain and you're trying to...
Well, he was living in his car for one thing. I mean, the guy was living in his car for most of it, Sean. I feel like for a little... that's how I remember hearing that.
I don't remember the issue with his parents, I knew that. But,
yeah, so.
But it was a lot of that, like, it's sort of, what are they called? The liars who, like, don't give up? What are those called?
Pathological liars.
Yeah, he was a pathological liar. So you can just, you know, that gave me a lot to dive into and find the character.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Sir, yeah, go for it.
So I'm on a mission this year to watch 365 movies. There we are. Yeah, I'm on a mission to watch 365, if you remember.
Yeah, we've been.
I met him in Rhode Island a couple of months ago. So I wanted to ask you guys, I finished your list, by the way. I wanted to ask you guys, have any suggestions for me? This was number 349.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh my God.
Wow. I'm going to throw three out really quick.
Yeah, you go.
While you can deliver on yours, because I'm a movie nerd. This is like all I want to do with my whole life. And now we're here. I would say The Last Detail, which is a Hal Ashby film with Jack Nicholson and Randy Quaid. I would say...
Force Mayor, you haven't seen that one, that's a good one.
So good.
Force Mayor is called?
The King of Comedy, the Scorsese film with De Niro. That's another great dark comedy of this. And then I'm going to throw out In America, which is a Jim Sheridan film shot in New York City about an immigrant family.
Also, there's a Goldie Hawn Steven Spielberg movie. It's like his first movie, I think one of the first movies that he ever did. That one, too.
Spielberg?
Yeah, with Goldie Hawn. It was one of the first
movies. Oh, wow.
Thank you. Sure.
Good luck on your endeavors.
Back there, though, if you would. Yeah.
I just wanted to ask, because the last film that I saw you in was The Bronze, and and this is also kind of in that same realm of like competitive, female-dominated sport, and is very competitive. So I was wondering if like. Feel like that role kind of prepared you to like dive in again, or if they're like completely separate?
Well, I really like dominating people. actually, I kind of did. But honestly, there's no connection, like in a way, because it's just, you know, just trying to work with, like, you know, it was great directors, and like that script was very funny to me, and it was just, you know, just happened to be one after the other, but there was no real connection.
You're skating on thin ice. I think we have two more minutes or two more questions.
Long ago.
Two more questions. Sebastian, get to the back, dude.
You're right there, with the wave. Yeah.
My wife will kill me if I ask the question.
She's a huge fan, so I'm gonna let her ask it.
Thank you both for coming out in a snowstorm and SantaCon. We appreciate it. Thank you for seeing and liking my Bad Boy video. It meant a lot.
Yes.
Oh yeah. Absolutely.
The question is, since we're all going to have to see this again because it's hysterical and tragic and amazing.
Yeah, you guys, you have seen it.
Are there any Easter eggs or inside jokes that we may have missed on the first pass that you can let us in on?
You say one, then I'll say one.
I don't know. I mean, there are.
I would say there's a moment. You go first.
Well, I was gonna say that, you know, I mean, it's not, you know, like that scene with the amazing Allison Janney, like when we're sitting down and she's like, "You two fuck yet," or whatever. Like that was totally improvised. It was not, our reaction. literally in the moment, like, no idea she was gonna do that. I think that's kind of come around and get her covered saying that because it was too good of a moment.
I have a moment where I know that I broke character, but the audience might not know. It's when we're in slow motion to like Fleetwood Mac's The Chain and we're in cuffs getting like reporters all around us. The actors who played the background actors who played all the reporters were trying to win an Academy Award. And they were like walking up to me just like, Sean, 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 Sean. And I was like trying to stay in character, but I was laughing my ass off because it was like so like over the top steroidal in their performance. So you can see me make a weird face where I'm cringing and smiling, and that's me trying not to laugh.
And the scene that where he and I are in the kitchen and I'm like, it was only mailing fucking letters that scene like basically like was us like in the Deer Hunter. I mean like
that was our heat.
We were a little, you know, like we were both so scared of like doing that scene and we were both like, we gotta be real actors. And then
we are
trying to screw with each other. Where like we would whisper things before the scene would happen, you know, like be like, I'm gonna destroy you.
He knows I'm like a practicing Christian. He went up to me between takes and goes, yeah, why don't you do the scene, go home and pray to your God tonight. I was so scared and so like, so
okay, and the whole turnaround is later on in the diner scene, okay, where in the diner scene that we're supposed to, you know, where he's got wiretapped or whatever, we're about to shoot and he comes up to me, just charges at me and goes, hey, I'm gonna fucking eat you alive. No, it doesn't work that way. You need me in this scene. I'm not against
it. Conflicting ideas about what the scene was.
Wait a minute. I thought we were. I'm like, no, you don't need me.
I'm here to bury you.
I'm really sorry.
I'm here to bury you.
So anyway, that was so bad.
Sorry, one more question. By the way, this light is like an angel giving birth. Oh my gosh.
So funny.
Hi. So I guess everyone's asking such wonderful questions. Was there a particular scene that you loved filming particularly? Like, because there's like so many like dynamic scenes with you and
No, good question. I would totally just say the kitchen scene where he and I square off and he finds out that I put the hit out on Tonya because we really were friends on set and we got along really well, but that was a night where you get to do the actor thing. Part of the actor thing is wanting to push yourselves and your boundaries and find interesting things as you go, and we were both up for the challenge. It was really fun.
Yeah, I mean, there was a lot of scenes that were, I would say that one's probably one of my favorites, but also just the whole montage with him in the car where we're driving. I mean, it was just really difficult to kind of keep a straight face and just have to keep telling ourselves.
Kenya, Korea.
These were people.
All right, are we good?
Go for one more, go ahead.
Okay, we're sweet.
I have a few, and you know, one of them is I love when Allison Janney goes, she's a soft four. And the other one that I have is the one that he has, which actually ended up being a very happy accident in the script, was when they ask him, they're like, what do you know about Tonya Harding? And he goes, I don't know what Tonya Harding or whatever. And that actually, Steven Rogers didn't write that, but they made a typo in the script.
I said the line and I didn't know that.
Right.
I would say my favorite line is, or at least the delivery, I love when he's talking about him and Tonya and their good times, and he goes, I would make her peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. It kills me. And then the line where I go, I shouldn't even be saying his name, Derek. The actual line was just, I know a guy, Derek. And then I keep talking. But when I read it, I go, oh, he only says Derek. It'd be funny if he said it like secretive. Like, I shouldn't even be saying his name. So that was an ad lib that they were like, I was thrilled they kept that in the movie.
Anyway.
And that's me patting my own back because I'm